Think back to an important memory from your childhood. Maybe it's winning a playoff game or relaxing by a beach on a hot summer's day. Can you recall your surroundings? The objects that are near you, the people that you're with? Can you smell the sea salt air or feel the sand in between your toes? With the use of neurotechnology, it may be possible to both improve the encoding of memories like these, or even stimulate these sensations without ever actually experiencing them. I'm Colin Fosnot, and in this video, we're going to talk about how neurotechnology can be used for cognitive enhancement, improving memory, and sensory substitution. Electronics that can modulate brain behavior fall under the classification of neuroelectric stimulation neuromodulation. There are several studies which have shown the potential for improving memory using devices in this class. Transcranial direct current stimulation, or TDCS, has been demonstrated to improve the speed at which implicit memory, otherwise known as muscle memory, is developed. Improvements in memory were found both in individuals with and without memory deficits. These studies all show that there's a real potential for memory encoding and recall to be improved with the addition of neurotechnology. A few studies also have shown that these benefits can persist 4 to 6 weeks after stimulation. Many within the neurotechnology field focus on restoring function to those who have either lost a limb or sensory organ. The cochlear implant, which has over 300,000 users worldwide, is an example of a sensory substitution device. The cochlea is a structure in your inner ear which is responsible for turning sound into electrical impulses that the brain can understand. Often, a deafness is caused by an issue with the cochlea or preceding structures. Cochlear implants use an electrode array threaded into the cochlea to stimulate the auditory nerve directly, simulating normal processes. This incredible technology has allowed for people who may have never experienced a sense of hearing to hear with relative clarity. One problem with cochlear implants is that they do not work for individuals who don't have an intact cochlea. Researchers have recently been trying to solve this problem by stimulating the brainstem directly, feeding sound into the brain while bypassing the cochlea entirely. These methods have shown promise in animals, and it's possible that we someday may be able to send a live audio feed directly to the brain without using any existing structures. Sight has also been restored to the blind using retinal implants. Retinal implants provide visual information to the person by collecting information directly from external cameras placed on glasses outside of the eye. The camera's feed is used to stimulate retinal neurons electronically, and, depending on how many retinal cells have survived, can create low-resolution images. Despite this exciting progress made, these implants are really only useful for basic light detection. However, there have also been some promising results with systems that bypass the eyes completely to directly stimulate the occipital cortex, which is the visual processing area of the brain. But the replacement of senses is just one of many uses for stimulatory neurotechnology. The brain, being as highly adaptable as it is, can make sense of many consistent data streams as inputs and learn to take on new senses. An excellent example of this is provided by David Eagleman's sensory substitution experiments. His lab showed how, through consistent tactile feedback from a vibration motor vest, a deaf user started to feel sound in words and learn to interpret them. As a fun example of what this technology can do, they outfitted one of the users with a vest that allowed the user to feel the ebbs and flows of the stock market and eventually start to interpret this as a native sense. This could be applied to many future applications that could change the ways we interact with data and enhance our bodies. In the future, it may be possible to put on a set of glasses that allows you to see any wavelength of the electromagnetic spectrum. In 2009, an experiment was designed to see if transcranial direct current stimulation could improve performance in verbal problem-solving tasks. Subjects were presented with three cue words that were then linked by a fourth word, which a participant would then need to correctly guess. An easy example of this are the words aid, rubber, and wagon. These are all linked by the word band. So, that's band-aid, rubber band, and bandwagon. The results of this research showed that stimulation of the left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex can improve complex verbal problem-solving skills. In one 2012 study, TDCS was shown to enable 40% of participants to solve a puzzle which required the connection of 9 dots organized in a 3x3 square grid. In the absence of this stimulation, no participant could solve the problem. But with the help of TPCS, participants were able to solve the puzzle. They stimulated the left and right anterior temporal lobes together to assist the participants in solving the problem. More research involving the improvement of human cognition using TDCS was conducted in 2009. In this study, the speed at which a planning task was performed was improved with no loss in terms of accuracy. Participants used the Tower of London test, which is very commonly used for assessing executive functioning, especially in regards to planning. In this test, the subjects must move one stack of rings from one peg to another in the correct order. Participants then plan the stacking and unstacking moves required to transform one board configuration into the other. The researchers concluded that both anodal and cathodal TDCS can improve planning performance. As we have mentioned many times, it's likely that we're just beginning to scratch the surface of the applications for medical neurotech. Things that seem unrealistic today may be possible with brain-computer interfaces. It may be possible in the future to provide a system that augments cognition for individuals who suffer from impaired brain functionality. One piece of media that brings this to mind is the book Flowers for Algernon by Daniel Keyes. In this book, the protagonist, who has a learning and cognitive disorder, is able to use technology to overcome these challenges to eventually become a genius. The moral implications of this piece of fiction may be a great framing device for future morality discussions if neuroaugmentation is ever actually feasible. One day, we may be able to stimulate the pleasure centers of the brain to combat drug addiction. If we continue to grow our understanding of the different areas of the brain and develop new ways of stimulation, it's very possible that addictions could become a thing of the past. Even more complexly, it may be possible in the future to manually evoke or negate certain thought patterns. That is to say, it may be possible to end things such as thought loops, where a person repeats the same thought over and over and is unable to escape the loop. Where a person repeats the same thought over and over and is unable to escape the loop. Over and over and unable to escape the loop. Where a person repeats the same thought, the same thought, over and over.
I'm Colin Fosner.
The future of brain-computer interfacing within the medical field seems bright. It's possible that, for many individuals, neurotechnologies will dramatically improve their quality of life and help mitigate a broad variety of issues. The insight we have gained from the use of this technology is truly remarkable. The potential that it appears to have to change the world and the way we think is great. Someday, it may be commonplace for students to stimulate certain areas of their brains before they take a test. Or maybe that'll be seen as cheating, and it'll be treated similarly to how steroids are treated in professional sports. Regardless, the possibilities for how we can directly change the way that humanity thinks is fascinating. In this video, we covered the possibility for neurotechnology to be used for cognitive enhancements, improving memory, and sensory substitution. We also briefly discussed potential medical uses for BCIs and considered how the future of these devices may change the way that we think. In our next lesson, we will discuss in more depth exactly how brain-computer interfaces currently work, discuss filtering and machine learning, and dive into specific uses that consumers may have for BCIs in the coming decades. Thanks for sticking around, and we'll see you next time.